Sports. It's week 9 of the NFL on EA Sports.
Coverage of the National Football League is on the air. The scene a few moments ago, here it is. It's unlike any other in sport as both teams made their way out of the tunnel. These folks are fired up as their guys are ready to do battle between the Denver Broncos and the Houston Oilers. With Charles Davis, I'm Brandon Gauden, and Charles, you take a look at our home side as we interplay here. They were winners last time out, so they'll be looking, Charles, to make it 2 in a row.
And what I enjoyed when I watched their game tape and their victory last week is they put it together in every phase. Good offense, good defense, and some key plays on special teams. Let's see if they can get that second win in a row.
Meanwhile, for the visiting Broncos, things haven't gone exactly according to plan to this point, but boy, you and I down there with them before the game, they were fired up.
And they understand how important this game is. Win this one, they can start to think about a turnaround.
So here are the Broncos now for their opening drive. And here's a look at their leader, standing 6'4".
And you've got to think that they've got to be feeling pretty fresh. You know, coming off of the open week, didn't have to play, right? Gives them a chance to rest up a little bit, heal some of those aches and pains, and excited about playing again. That really rekindles things a little bit. I want to see how they come out and establish themselves here early.
And that bye week coming right where they want it, in the middle of the schedule. Going right side here, and that's complete. And up to the 35 before they're able to knock him down. It'll be a gain of 10 to start the drive out, and by a few inches, that'll be a first down. Breaks a tackle, now an alley. He's got a first down and then some at midfield. And out of bounds on the other side of midfield at the 45. Well, I tell you what, when you get a running back who can move like that in the open field, that's something to take advantage of, and they certainly did there.
And first and foremost, this is all about vision. He can see the play developing right in front of him. And once he's past the line of scrimmage and got a full head of steam behind him, he's just going to keep right on going.
And according to Next Gen Stats, his top speed on that one, better than 20 miles an hour. So a first and 10 now in Houston territory at the 45-yard line. From the shotgun now, here's an inside give. Now he is going to be stopped cold behind the line of scrimmage. Officially, it's a 1-yard loss. That's going to bring up second and 11.
Second and 11 at the 46-yard line.
Second and 11. Looking for his running back, and he's got him. 6 yards on the pickup, and that'll lead here to a third down.
They've got good playmakers on the offensive side of the ball. I don't know what happened last week to really hurt their performance and hold down their production, but I would dare say that this week in practice, there's a lot of talk about how they're going to increase their proficiency.
And that was a good start, getting the playmakers involved. You mentioned that to me pregame. That's what they did there.
Yeah, I think a lot of people think the coaching staff really gets on them and that's how they motivate them. Most of these guys are self-motivated. They have a lot of pride in their performance.
So from the 17 now, here's a first and 10. And again, this time to the tailback. And this time they were ready for him as they'll stop him right at the line of scrimmage. No gain on the play there, second down. So after the run for no gain, here's second and 10. Now a handoff here to his running back. And again, he's going to be stopped up right at the line of scrimmage. Back-to-back stops make it third and 10.
Gain on the play.
I know the scouting report on him is that he doesn't possess the eye discipline to be an elite linebacker. What that means is his ability to read, react, and make a play. But on that one, he looked like one of those guys.
Being chased out left. And a nice job there defensively to contain him and get him to the ground a few yards short of the first down marker. Pretty solid gain of 7 yards that time as he scrambled, but now they face a fourth down.
I liked his effort there. He got it done on his own, but let's face it, he puts defenses in a really stressful spot when he takes off and runs because a lot of guys have coverage responsibilities.
Good job of rallying, though, because I thought when he first took off, he might pick up the first down.
Oilers, how big?
Well, after marching down the field, only getting 3 there, kind of feels like a win for the defense.
And it does. They'll go to the sideline feeling a lot better that they didn't give up a touchdown after the march against them. But if I were the offense, I wouldn't hang my head over that one. That's a good drive, and 3 points were put on the board.
So out comes this offense to take over for the first time. And a look here at their go-to guy under center.
And his stat line last week, that's not going to get him to the Pro Bowl. All right, no touchdowns, no interceptions, but they won. And so the bottom line for him is team won, managed the game effectively, led them to victory. He's doing all the right things.
And he's going to lose yardage here, back to his own 18. That one unable to develop, never got going. A loss of a couple, and it's second down.
I like the idea to mix it up from time to time because let's face it, you can't be predictable. But the execution was a little lacking on this one, right? They might want to go back to the drawing board with that call.
The second down attempt there knocked down as it leaves the quarterback's hand, and it's incomplete.
One thing that you're going to see from this offense is that they love the matchup with their wide receivers against this secondary. That one wasn't successful, but don't expect them to back away from attacking all game long.
He gets it to Brown, complete. And all the way down to the 22-yard line. It's a big play there on third down. And even 60 yards. Pretty good timing. He waited just enough for that post play to develop and laid it right in there.
And you know what a lot of teams do when they decide to throw a post route? Because it's a little bit longer developing play, they max protect. Bring everyone in, keep the tight end in, an extra back to make sure the quarterback has time to deliver the football.
Give him 4 yards there. It'll be second and 6.
But that call makes sense because they've been throwing it well on this drive, and once again, they show passing formation, showing the shotgun. Then they ran out of it. That's a nice play by them defensively, though, to hold it to a short game.
Oh, the ball comes out on the hit, but they'll say it's incomplete.
It's been a good opening drive offensively thus far, but you know they don't want to waste it and settle for a field goal attempt after that incompletion. So this is a big play coming up here on third down.
Meanwhile, on third down, they take a shot at the end zone, but it's incomplete.
Well, they've got man coverage on the outside, and my scouting report on these DBs tells me that they love to take matters in their own hands. They want man coverage, not zone, and there was good coverage there that forced the incompletion.
So a return of... to their timeouts as they'll stop it with exactly a minute to go before halftime. So from the 39 now, they'll come up on a first and 10. They'll stick with the passing game as he looks to throw. Throwing left side here and it's complete. Now the Broncos going to use the second of their timeouts as the clock will stop with 55 seconds to go until halftime. Finding a safety valve here. That's complete. And he'll be brought down at the 45-yard line. 6 yards to pick up, and that's a first down. Oh, he'll air this one deep for Judy. And he fires one that's intercepted. Picked up by Minkah Fitzpatrick. And it's a good return here as he'll get all the way up close to the 35. Now whistles here, and we've got a man down. Man down on the field. We'll check on his status when we get back. Final 24 seconds of the first half as they come up here first and 10. They'll try and start this drive in the air. And that is incomplete. He couldn't hold on through the contact. Brings up second down. From the 34, they'll come to the line on second and 10. And that is incomplete. Down to 15 seconds now.
83, incomplete. Brings up third down.
And now they face a third and 10 after back-to-back incompletions. From the shotgun, he'll look to throw. And that's incomplete. Clock stops with 10 seconds left. So they bring out their punter as he's on to punt for the first time this afternoon. And the win last week punted 4 times as this one's away. 37 yards on the punt with no return. And there'll be time for maybe one final play before halftime. The white flag coming out as they line up to kneel on it. And with time running short here, they'll simply take a knee, and that should do it for half number one. So we have come to halftime in what's already a 2-touchdown game. As we send you on over to Orlando for Jonathan Coachman in our EA Sports Halftime Report. Take it away, Coach.
Okay, all right, Brandon. Thank you very much. Hi again, everyone. Let's get you caught up with what's going on around the NFL as we are officially into the second half of the season. We'll get started out in the capital city of Austin, Texas. And that one just before halftime with the Jaguars out on top. DJ Chark, a touchdown reception. From there, we head down south to Atlanta to check on the Falcons at home at Mercedes-Benz Stadium. And for the moment, they trail the visiting Saints in that one. The Saints seem to be on their way to what would be a good victory. Lastly, let's head to Paul Brown Stadium in Cincinnati, see what's happening with the Bengals. And they have the lead in that one over the visiting Indianapolis Colts. The Bengals looking to sew that one up, and they look to be in pretty good shape. Meanwhile, in our game, it's been a back-and-forth first half. Who can put it together in the second half? For the answer, we turn it back over to our broadcast team of Brandon Godden and Charles Davis.
All right, Coach, thank you, and we welcome everyone back for quarter number 3. Down. That's going to be caught by Judy. 5 yards on the catch there. Brings up second down. You got the big lead defensively. Willing to give them that underneath stuff, right?
And this is why you work on your tackling. Tackle them after the catch, inbounds, keep the clock running. Just go ahead and bleed the game out that way.
Now the second down throw on target. And he'll get it down here to the 43. 6 yards to pick up, and that's a first down.
It's a gain of 6. And the Broncos first down.
They'll look to throw again. Gonna throw right side here. Complete. It'll be a pickup of 10 yards. And that'll bring up a second and just about a few inches here. They still need about the length of the football here, maybe a little less as they come up on second and inches. So it's Bronco football as we get you reset here. And let's see what they've come up with offensively after having time to talk it over. Now here's to throw right side, taken in by his tight end.
And he's got this down almost to the 20 before he's dropped.
12 yards there and a first down.
Now that was a fun one to watch right there. A nice in-breaking route and plenty of room in the middle of the field. And he was able to get behind the linebackers and grab the completion for a really good pickup.
Nothing open downfield. He keeps it himself for 11 and a first down. To the end zone, but it's incomplete.
As defensive coordinators around the league tell me all the time, that throw is not for every quarterback because you've really got to drive the ball downfield. It's going to be a tight window for him to fit that one into. In this case, unsuccessfully.
Looking end zone, but it's incomplete.
And now following the incomplete pass, we'll get a timeout here for an injured player.
This offense was on the move. Now two straight incompletions have him looking at 3rd and 10.
While the training staff works on him, we'll step aside and be right back.
And it's intercepted at the goal line. Read it well, and it's picked. And he'll go down inside the 15 at his own 13-yard line. For this defense, CeeDee, that's kind of the icing on the cake here as we get to the end of this one.
And didn't you feel that they weren't just going into total prevent there? You know, they had the lead, and sometimes you fall back and you lose your aggressiveness. Not in this case. They were still making a play on the football, and look how that one turned out. They may have salted this one away.
From the 13 now, they work on 1st and 10. And he'll give it here to his running back. And out of bounds across the 15-yard line. It's a 6-yard pickup, and it gets him to 2nd and 4.
At the 18-yard line, it's a pickup of 6. Brings up 2nd and 4.
And a give this time to the tailback. And tackled down after a gain of 3. Leaves him with 1 yard to go on 3rd down.
That's it. That's what you want. Straight ahead, positive gain. Just keep that clock ticking.
Heavy set out there on 3rd and 1. Now a handoff here to his running back. And he's going to get the first down as they bring him down at the 23. So Houston going to come away here with the victory. And I think the game balls need to be distributed on the defensive side of the football, and I bet that you would agree.
Yeah, if you hold a team under 10 points, that's a job well done. Really well done. So I would say game balls for every starter and every key player who participated in this game.
Now, see, I only like one game ball. You're handing out multiple, although I set you up by saying game balls, plural.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
I
like where we're going with this, though. You say one to represent, like, the best player of all that. And I say multiples so that you keep everyone motivated and involved.
You're a man of the people.
I'm a man of the people. I thought I was the only child.
You get a game ball, and you get a game ball. Game balls for everybody. So for the home team here, they'll finish the first half of the schedule dead even at 4-4. And they'll hit the road next week to take on the Arizona Cardinals. Meanwhile, for the Broncos, they fall 2 games under 500 now at 3-5. And they'll try and turn things around next week as they have a date at MetLife Stadium with the New York Jets. So that'll do it for us. For my partner, Charles Davis, and all the hard-working men and women on our crew, I'm Brandon Gaughan. You've been watching the NFL right here on EA Sports. With that, we say so long, everybody.